All right, this is Math 1332, Video Lesson, Chapter 2, Sets, or Set Theory. Okay, before we start talking about the homework assignments and all those different assignments, we have to define a bunch of words. Section 2.1. Basic set concepts. We have to define a bunch of words first. So, the first one we've got. What is a set? We're talking about set theory, so what's a set? Set is a collection of objects not just any objects they have to be able to be that must be or that can be clearly determined or defined. And they can be physical objects, they can be concepts, but they're set with parts of the set. The objects in a set are called elements or members of a set. Okay, so a set must be well defined. When we talk about well-defined sets, we're talking about a set whose contents, whose elements, whose members can be clearly defined, determined, or defined. So, a set, sets can be described by words, call this the roster, another one is a method, roster method. The roster method is a list inside these squiggly brackets separated by commas, and going like, for example, the alphabet is a set. Another way we can define a set, sets are always capital letters. We can use something called the set builder notation. This is called the set builder notation. Set notation is the set A is equal to the set, that means the set. We give them the elements of the set that are X, such that X is an element of the real numbers, and X is between 3 and 5. We'll discuss what all that means still later. Okay. A set can be empty. An empty set is designated by that symbol or those brackets with nothing inside there. Do not represent an empty set like this, because this represents a set. If you put the empty that little symbol inside there, that set has one element. Empty set has no elements. Alright, so you have to be very careful. If you're going to define an empty set, either put that zeroth line through it or the squiggly lines. Okay, earlier I used this symbol. The symbol means is an element of. What that means is an object. In the set. Is a member of the set. So again, we have a lot of these words. If you have this symbol, it means it's not a member of the set. Okay, so it could be either an element is a member of the set, or it's not. Alright, now let's look at numbers. How can we represent numbers in sets? We begin by talking about, let's say, counting numbers. Counting numbers are the ones, if I ask you to start counting, you start 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you go on forever. Those are the counting numbers. In mathematics, we call those the natural numbers. And we use a symbol like that. That symbol there means natural numbers. So those are 1, 2, 3, so on and so forth. Then, if we have the natural numbers, the counting numbers, the natural numbers plus the number 0 we call those whole numbers. Easiest way is you just included a whole in there. And for there we use this symbol. It's a W to represent the whole numbers. So that one starts at 0 and it goes on to infinity. Alright, then the next set of numbers that we have from inside there are the integers. Because we have numbers to the left of it on a number line. If we include the negative numbers, then we have the set of integers. We use the z. So the integers z is all the negative numbers, 0, and all the positive numbers. So we have that so far. Now, any number can be represented as a fraction. Remember, natural numbers, whole numbers, integers, those are just the solid numbers. What about the numbers in between there? The number 3 is the same thing as 3 over 1. So it can be written as a fraction. Or 3 over 5. Or 7 over 9. Now we're talking about numbers between these integers. Those are called rational numbers. Fractions. Ratio means fractions. For that, we use the Q. Quotient. Quotient simply means fraction. All right. And then all these quotients are solid, real numbers. They make up the real number system. Real numbers is a set of all rational and irrational numbers. Again, rational numbers are numbers that we can use. Irrational numbers symbol I basically are defined not rational numbers. So they're either going to be rational or irrational. The difference between the two. Rational numbers have finite decimal or repeating decimals. Finite decimal is like 2.347. It stops. There's nothing else. Or repeating 2.343434. And since we know it repeats forever, to make it easier for us, we represent it with this bar on top. So whenever you see a bar on top of a number, you know that means that number repeats itself over and over and over and over and over and over. Irrational numbers do not stop or repeat. For example, pi. 3.14159. It goes on infinitely. So far, so good. Now, when you see here, then we know that the rational numbers and irrational numbers are contained in the real numbers. But now we have another set of numbers. We call these complex numbers. These are represented by C for complex. A complex number can be written as an imaginary number. That's where this I comes in. It's imaginary. Or it's a combination of imaginary and real numbers. This is imaginary. This is real. So a complex number is made up of an imaginary or real number. Therefore, 3 is an imaginary number. It's got no imaginary, that means it's complex. It has no imaginary numbers, and it has a real number. The number 4i. It has 4 in the imaginary and no real. Or we can have a combination of both. It has the real and the imaginary part. So the complex numbers and all the real numbers make up what we call the universe of all numbers. And that's any type of numbers we can think of. Alright, so that's when we talk about numbers. It's pretty cool. And that defines all this sort of stuff. So, let's look at this next one. Section 2. Actually, we haven't finished this first set, have we? No. We have to talk about what are called, since we're talking about sets, so we have set A. The set A is made up of 1, 2, 3, the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. And set B is made up of the letters A, B, C, D. The way we represent the number of elements in a set, the number of elements in a set are called the cardinal numbers. It tells us the number of elements in a set. And it's represented this way. The N, that stands for the cardinal number, and what set you're talking about. So the cardinal, we call it the cardinality. So the cardinality of A, of the set, is 1, 2, 3, 4. It's just a physical number. The cardinality of B is also 4. So, since A and B have the same cardinality, we say they're equivalent sets. Sets that have the same cardinality, or same cardinal number. Now what that means is every element in A corresponds to one and only one element in B. So they have to be equal size. So far, we're good. Yeah. If we have an infinite set, that means the cardinality is infinity. A finite set it has some number. Let's say then, if A was an empty set, in other words, if A, the cardinality of A would be zero. Because of this complexity here, the easiest way to memorize this is a finite set is a set whose cardinality is zero. Or some solid number. And if a set has a cardinality that's not zero or a number is said to be an infinite set. Make sure it focuses there. Alright, now let's look at, since we talked about sets, let's look at subsets. A subset is basically this. If every element of set A is also in set B, then A is a subset of B. And we use that symbol. So when we say A, that symbol, that's what it means. It means A is a subset of B. That means every element of A is in B. If you have this symbol, if you have that symbol, that should mean A has that. Set A is not a subset of set B. What does that mean? There is at least one element of set A that is not in set B. So, if A equals 1, 2, 3, and B is 1, 2, 4, 5, since A has 3 and B doesn't, then A is not a subset of B. But if B had, if A had set 1, 2, 3, and B had 1, 2, 3, 4, then A, since all A is in B, A is a subset of B. Right, we have two types of subsets. We have proper and improper subsets. A proper subset we use this notation. Remember, in subset, in subsets, we use because it can equal. Proper subsets, we use this notation. Let me make sure that this is how it's defined. Set A is a proper subset of B, set B, if A does not equal B. So, in other words, if they're not equal, then they're proper subsets. What does that mean? If two sets are equal, then every element in set A is exactly the same elements, in set B. They have the same list of elements. So that's how we know if two sets are equal. The number of subsets and the number of proper subsets can be determined by a calculation. 2 to the power n, where n is the number of elements that you have. N is the number of elements. and the number of proper subsets is given by this equation. Remember, it has to have at least one difference. So that's the formula for it. Let's see example here. Let's say A, set A, has the members 1, 2, 3, 4. It has four elements. The number of subsets that A can have is 2 to the power 4. It's 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. 2, 4, 8, 16. So you can have 16 subsets from this. And I'll show you how to make those in a second. Then the proper subsets is 2 to the power n minus 1. Since we had 2 to the power 4. I'm sorry. Since n equals 4 in this case. So we have 16 minus 1. That equals 15. So, let's look at this. Let's say set A is made up of the numbers 1 and 2. So n is 2. So subsets is 2 to the power 2. We can make 4 subsets. Proper subsets is 2 to the power 2 minus 1. That's 3. So, with this, we can make a subset, or set 1 and 2, just 1, just 2, and the empty set, So the subset, the empty set, the null set, is a subset of every set, but a proper subset is one of those is taken up. So let's say we get rid of that one. 1, 2, and the empty set. 1, 2, 3. So that's the difference between the two. Number of distinct proper subsets and subsets. Alright, the next thing we're going to discuss are Venn diagrams. The letter U, when you receive the letter U, it represents the universal set. The universal set is the set that contains all of the elements. Considered. That's you. So for example, let's say the universe that we're going to deal with is are the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Remember it's a set, so we have to put the squiggly lines. And a set set A are the numbers 1, 2, 4, and 7. A Venn diagram when we draw a pentagram, always start off with a square. That square represents the universe. Set A, in this case, label the set. It's made up of 1, 2, 4, and 7. So, 1, 2, 4, and 7 are in set A. Whatever's not in set A, that's in the universe, has to be listed out here. So we have 3, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10. So that's how you develop a Venn diagram. And there are four prominent ways of describing. If we had two sets, let's look at the possibilities if we have two sets. Again, this, you have two sets. You have set A and you have set B. They have nothing in common. Here's the universe. We call this disjoint. They have nothing in common. The second one we look at is if you have one set inside another. That's set B and that's set A. This is called proper subset. The next one are called equal sets. Where set A has exactly the same elements as set B. So it could be disjoint, have nothing in common. It could be proper subsets, one inside of the other. They could be equal sets, or they can have some things together. They have some elements in common with at least one element not in common. Element not in common. And this is where they have, that's where they intersect. That's what they have in common. That's in common. And this is what they don't have in common. So let's look at our earlier one. This, we have the universe is the numbers of 1, 2, all the way up to 10. We said set A was 1, 2, 4, 7. And when we drew it, we had the universe, we had set A, which is 1, 2, 4, 7. This one's made up of 3, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10. So whatever's not in set A, we call that the complement of A. The complement is all elements in set A, but are in the universe. Now, the symbol we use for the complement is that little symbol there. Whenever you see that little symbol there, it means the complement. Two sets can have common elements. That is called the intersection. That's what intersections define. Elements in common with all sets. Here's universe. Here's set A. Here's set B. That is the intersection. That's what they have in common. Again, the universe, all numbers 1 through 10. If A was 1, 2, 4, 7, and set B was 1, 4, 5, 8, 9, the intersection, we use that symbol, is just what they have in common. It's 1 and 4. So the intersection, the symbol we use there is this N. Intersection. Because the other one we use is the union. The union of two sets are all elements in both sets A and B. So again, the universe is all the numbers from 1 to 10. A is 1, 2, 4, 7. Set B is 1, 4, 5, 8, 9. The symbol for union is a U. That separates to separate the universe. We put little things on top. So the A union B are everything in A and B. So we have number 1, 2, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9. Don't write repeated numbers. So you notice they both have a 2 in common, or a 4 in common, and a 1. Just write it one time. Seven here, 5, 8, 9. It's everything. It's just what they had in common. They had 1 and 4. A had 2 and 7 left, and B had 5, 8, 9. So the intersection is just where they overlap, which is what they have in common. The union is everything in set A, everything at B, and even where they intersect. I'm going to write that once. So let's look at operations now. Look at operations dealing with sets. Say the universe, all the numbers from 1 to 7. Set B is 1, 2, 3. Set C is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What if we're asked to find, first off, let's find B union C. Let's find B intersection C and B union C. Remember, this means complement. So the first one. The universe goes here. Here's set B. Set C. Again, see what they have in common. They have a 2 and a 3. So 2 and 3 go right here. Since 1 is left, it goes there in B. 4, 5, and 6 go here. So B union C means everything in B, everything in C, and everything else. It equals